session, which is the debate. And I am going to invite the next chairpersons, Dr. M. Ramesh from Bangalore, Dr. Rajesh Khullar from Delhi, Dr. Albert Kiangte from Guwahati. So I wouldn't like to lose this time because debates are always fun to watch. And we have Dr. Andrew Deboo from all the way from Edinburgh and Dr. Ramesh Punjani from Mumbai giving up a big fight on this great, great topic. I pass my mic to Dr. M. Ramesh, Dr. Khullar and Dr. Kiangte.
Yeah, good evening. Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to this session of debate. And it's really wonderful. Sarfaraz, you have done really great job. And we are fortunate to be together on Zoom for this wonderful session. Hi, Naeem. Good to see all of you. I welcome both the panelists, Dr. Ramesh Punjani and Dr. Andrew Deboo. Dr. Ramesh Punjani, he is a senior surgeon from Fortis Hospital, Mumbai. He is one of the pioneers of abdominal wall surgery, and many surgeons in India, they have learned the newer abdominal wall repair techniques from Dr. Ramesh Punjani. So he will be speaking that a linear elbow closure is essential for abdominal wall repair for functional restoration when we are repairing an abdominal wall hernia, whether it is primary hernia or it is inguinal hernia. And against him, we have a stalwart, Dr. Andrew Deboo. He is the general and upper GI surgeon, Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh, honorary senior lecturer, the University of Edinburgh. Most of us know Andrew. He is half Indian. he has stayed long enough in India to be qualified for that. And he will be saying against Dr. Punjani. He will be speaking that linear elbow closure is not really that important for functional restoration of abdominal wall. Both the speakers, they have 10 minutes each. Is it?
12 minutes.
10 minutes each.
12 minutes.
12 minutes each. 12 minutes each, and then 3 minutes rebuttal.
Okay. Let's keep it to 2 minutes because, sir, you need to wrap up with the final comments also.
Okay. That will be done by Ramesh. So I asked Ramesh Punjani to put his case.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a kind introduction. I thank IAGS and the Royal College of Surgeons at Edinburgh to go for this debate. I'm going to talk about this presentation, a linear elbow closure essential. Greetings from Mumbai. I'm going to talk on linear elbow is essential for AWR for functional restoration. I have no conflicts of interest. Before I start my presentation, I have a gratitude. I'm indebted from Professor Yuri Novitsky, Columbia University, New York, USA, for clearing my concepts in abdominal wall reconstruction. Now, if you see the linear elbow in Gray's anatomy textbook, it just goes by these two diagrams, and where what he writes is the linear elbow is a tendinous raphe in the midline of the abdomen, stretching between the ziphoid process and the symphysis pubis. So this is what is a linear elbow. And if you see, just note the word tendinous raphe. And now if you see the dictionary meaning of raphe, it is a seam-like union between two parts. So it is a structure which two different parts of the body are brought together, and that is where it actually seals them together. It is like a seam of a ball. Histology of linear elbow. Somebody has done this collagen fibers in linear elbow study on histology under the microscope. This has been presented in Journal of Surgical Research, January 2001, and they found there is a three-dimensional, highly structured meshwork of collagen fibers. So linear elbow is consisting of three-dimensionally spread collagen fibers. There is another anatomy journal of Africa where they have also found that three-dimensionally placed substantial amount of elastic fibers. What it goes to say is that the linear elbow is robust structure which maintains the integrity of abdominal wall. So it is one of the toughest structures of the abdominal wall, which needs to be restored if it is violated. The abdominal wall has been likened to a musculotendinous structures. Now here we see a forearm, and in forearm there are a number of muscles. Each muscle has a tendon, and that gets inserted into a bone across the joint. So when the muscle contracts, the tendon transmits that, and that's how the mobility happens. Similarly, all the movements of the abdomen needs a tendon, a central tendon on which all three obliques and the central muscles are directly or indirectly attached. And that is, this attachment is very important for them to function. So linea alba is a tendon of abdominal muscles. All muscles function through intact linea alba. And laparotomy is equivalent to tenotomy. So if you are dividing a tendon, we must repair a tendon. And therefore, closure of the abdomen is a tendon repair. If you see the European Hernia Society guidelines for closure of the abdominal wall, what they say is that for closure of the midline abdominal wall incision in elective surgery, a single layer aponeurotic closure, mind you, single layer aponeurotic closure is nothing but the linea alba, that needs to be sutured. The importance of linea alba, in fact, is known since quite some time. The August Ruber was in early 18th century, a German embryologist and an anatomist. He made a very good observation. What he says is that anything that is important in the body has got a bony case. For example, the skull, the brain is in the skull box, the trachea, the windpipe, which has got a cartilaginous tissue in front and a vertebrae behind. The entire lung and the thorax are within the thoracic cage, and all the reproductive organs are in the pelvic ring. What is not there is the abdomen, where it is surrounded, which is protected by the vertebra behind, but there is a linea alba in front. And what he says is that a large gap in the skeletal system between lower edges of the thorax and the upper edge of the pelvis is lacuna skeletae sternopubica. This term was coined by August Ruber, which means that linea alba is the skeleton of the abdominal wall. If you see the functions of the abdominal wall, the abdominal cavity is likened to be an intact cylinder. So it is a cylinder which is bound by the thoracoabdominal diaphragm on the top, pelvic diaphragm below, vertebrae behind, and entry abdominal wall, which is intact. Now, what is the function of it? It protects the viscera. It supports the spine and maintains the posture. Now, what happens is when the thorax and the pelvis is fixed and the both the diaphragms contract and the abdominal muscles contract, there is a positive pressure generated inside, which can then use it to pass urine. It can be used to pass stools, or it can also help you in delivery of the child for a woman. So these are the physiological activities like urination, defecation, and parturition. The abdominal wall plays a very important role. It has been also found that intact abdominal wall gives sensation of satiety and prevents the obesity. Now, what happens in mental hernia? There is a rupture in the cylinder. So this is the same cylinder, but now what has happened is it is ruptured. That is led to a big hernia. Now, this hernia, these functions will suffer because now what will happen, all the pressure will now start going inside, outside the, into the sac, and there won't be any effective pressure for them to do a physiological activity. If you see a ventral hernia, which is actually a disruption of linea alba, what happens is that there is an unopposed contraction of the oblique muscles. Now this will increase the disruption, and that's why we always see that the hernia increases in size. And what happens is these unused muscles, because there is nothing to contract again, they are not inserted here, so they remain sort of unused and they become atrophy and become fibrous. So that is what is the pathology of ventral hernia. So if we have to really reconstruct them properly, we must attach them to the midline for them to again regrow. And I will show in my later of my presentation where actually they grow in size if you do a proper AWR. So goal in treatment of large ventral hernia of this size is abdominal wall reconstruction, which is a structural reconstruction which can lead to a functional restoration. Now, if this is the God-given abdominal wall, so this is a construction where you can see a midline close to recta and three obliques. Now, this is a disruption where the hernia has happened either here or lateral. Then what is a reconstruction? According to me, reconstruction is recreating original construction. That means the point A must come to A dash. So you have to close all the defects and you have to construct the midline if you want to achieve a functional results. The goal of surgery of large ventral hernia is closing the parietal defect, restore the insertion of lateral muscles on the linea alba, restore the intra-abdominal pressure, and resect redundant skin. So restoring the structural integrity of the abdominal wall restores the abdominal wall functions. Are there any evidence? Yes, there is a lot of evidence. The four principles of complex of abdominal wall reconstruction. So if you see, this is a paper which is by the Khansa et al. Plastic and Digital Surgery in 2019. And in the second principle, which is selection of correct procedure, They say to minimize the risk of hernia recurrence and bulge, two principles should be followed. Primary musculofacial closure and reinforcement of the mesh. So they have insisted this as a very important step of AWR. And they provide dynamic abdominal wall that can resist the stress and strain leading to lower rate of hernia recurrence than the interpositional bridge mesh repairs. So this has categorically ruled out any interpositional bridge mesh repairs but closure of the midline. This is a study done by the Nowitzki and the Rosen's group, appeared in 2014 in Surgery Journal. It said functional abdominal wall reconstruction improves the core physiology. And what they conclude is restoration of the linea alba, improved abdominal wall functionality, and also improved the quality of life. There is still another paper, the breakthrough on evolution and treatment of an incisional hernia with loss of domain. Here they have demonstrated that a mesh can never replace the tenacious fascia of the linea alba, and hence it is hard for abdominal muscles to recover from status of hypertrophy or fibrillation. Thus, it carries a higher chance of recurrence. So if you don't close linea alba, you are asking for a recurrence. This is another paper by component separation versus a bridge repair. This was done in 2016 by the Hohan et al. And what they concluded, the bridge repair was associated with more SSOs than was a primary facial closure. A primary facial closure should be used whenever possible. Let's see what we see this kind of cases. I see the day in and day out. So you have a big large ventral hernia defect of around 16 centimeter. What it needs is an abdominal wall reconstruction. To me, that is a midline reconstruction. And see how nice the entire anatomy has come into a place. Similarly, this is another lady with a large hernia with a loss of domain. The same lady 1 year down the line, you can see an absolutely well-constructed midline. And if you see the CT scan of the same lady when she presented, you can see a rolled up recti, thinned out obliques and a large defect with loss of domain. Same lady, after a 1 year of surgery, the CT scan and the same sequence is showing a quietly well-aligned and hypertrophied recti and then quite well-aligned obliques and a muscle, the midline close. So this is a restoration. This lady, before the surgery, when she was coughing, you can see the amount of functional problem that she has. And the same lady, 1 year down the line, has got absolutely no bulge. So it causes a functional restoration. So ladies and gentlemen, I strongly believe a linea alba closure is essential for abdominal wall reconstruction. Thank you very much. And all over to Andrew, my good friend.
Thank you, Ramesh. It was an excellent presentation. And you have put your point very well. And to some extent, I also quite agree with you what you have tried to prove, that yes, linea alba closure or restoration of linea alba is very important for abdominal wall functional. And now I invite Andrew to put his case forward. Yes, Andrew, please.
Dr. Kula, thank you very much. And Dr. Punjani, it's a privilege to follow you. These are my disclosures, and I'm assuming that you can all hear me and see me. We have lots of ideas and beliefs in the world, and there's no doubt, as this very famous author identified, that ideas, if they're our own, they become sticky. And these are two very sticky ideas in abdominal wall repair: linea alba closure and tension-free closure. We know that as soon as the patient wakes out, there's abdominal tone, and we know that there's 400 coughs per day post-op. So tension-free is nonsense, and I put it to you that linea alba closure is nonsense. Now, let's take our midline hernia. We've got a defect here. And when the patient tenses the muscles, yes, there's lateral retraction, and we have a functional problem here. So you would make sense, let's close the midline. But what about this hernia? This is a lateral hernia. The midline is intact. Linea alba is intact. Does that mean we don't have to repair it? What nonsense. Of course, when there's a contraction, we're going to have a problem here. So it's not just the midline. We've heard of this cylinder. And yes, there needs to be a cylinder of muscle, but it's not muscle. Muscle is not much used by itself. It's a myofascial ring. Muscle is not really that important at maintaining the integrity. We need some muscle, but we need an intact myofascial ring. So much about abdominal wall function is done like this, by doing some form of abdominal crunch. But let me tell you, unless you want to look like this, or you go around as a caveman dragging things, having a good six-pack is of very little value to you, except when you're on the beach. And we talk about the linea alba. The linea alba, ladies and gentlemen, is the emperor's clothes. You can see it on this CT scan. Well, actually, you can't. It's so small, you can't see it. Let me give you a magnified view. You can hardly see it. Is this the key to abdominal wall function? Surely not. And the reason for this myth has come in because every drawing I've seen in this conference so far draws the linea alba like this, some massive, thick structure. That's what it's like. You can hardly see it. Stitches cut through it, pull out of it, talking about closure of the poor linea alba. It's the emperor's clothes, ladies and gentlemen. It almost doesn't exist. So we have this situation of a hernia. We've got this concept that we have to bring everything together, restore the perfect anatomy. What happens to all this tissue? Well, it's got to be squashed in here. This is the relative loss of domain. You raise abdominal pressure and it falls apart. Yes, you can do a variety of things to try and improve the situation. And as you know, I'm a great fan of the peritoneal flap repair. But component separation, it's cutting something. We were told we had to restore everything, but component separation is destructive to the abdominal wall. A lot of forces, we can sum it into one. There'll be the muscles pulling the poor linea alba apart. We'll have some fixation, but on day one, it's pure mechanical fixation. There's no tissue in growth to matter. And then we see pulling together tissues. Remember, the muscles have been apart for a while. And as we pull it together, we see all the little tears in the linea alba in the anterior rectus sheet. Remember that the line of pull of the fascia is horizontal. Our stitches are going in between the gaps of the tissues, and they will tear as we tighten it. We've all seen the anterior rectus sheath and linea alba tearing as we put it in. And we've heard, what about bridging? Bridging is a terrible thing. Well, let me tell you a little bit about bridging. Bridges are very useful at some time, but they have to be built strong. If you have a flimsy bridge, yes, it'll fall down, but a strong bridge, let me tell you, it will hold together. And as you know, I populate the peritoneal flap technique. This is the blue line shows the suture line between the anterior rectus sheath on this side, the anterior rectus sheath on this side, and the hernial sac this side. And the ink line here tells us this is the medial edge of the ARS, the medial edge of the ARS, and it is bridged, in inverted commas, with the hernial sac or the peritoneal flap. Getting this to there was no way without cutting somewhere else. So yes, it's a bridging repair, but that was a gentleman you saw at closure. This was him looking pregnant. And this is him 2 years later with a functional, well-defined abdomen that works. But his linea alba is not together. For me, this is one of the interesting key papers. All the other papers that we've heard Dr. Punjani presented were based on people's ideas and beliefs. But this is hard evidence. This is what happens if you try and get linea alba together. So this is a series from my colleague Agneta Montgomery from Malmo. And they did 96 standard rectorectus or sublay operations, and they did 78 modified peritoneal flap. They have a slight modification to our operation. That doesn't really matter. These modified peritoneal flap group had slightly bigger hernias. They were much more likely to have concomitant GI surgery, and GI surgery increases the risk of wound infection and thus recurrence from the hernia. And they were more likely to have a stoma present, which also increases the risk of recurrence. So I'm setting you up here. Okay, we have a larger, more GI operations, more stoma in this group. These group are going to do badly, aren't they? Here are the results. Yes, the follow-up is not quite so long in this group, but the short-term complications were the same. Interestingly, patient satisfaction was higher in the modified peritoneal flap technique. But ladies and gentlemen, if I can demonstrate this slide here, a tenfold reduction in incisional hernia recurrence. Let me say that again, a tenfold reduction with a so-called bridging technique without restoring the linea alba. I'm not sure if I have to say anything more, but I've got five more minutes, so I will keep talking. Why might a peritoneal flap and a so-called bridging technique be better? Well, I've alluded to this already with some of my diagrams. Use of the flap may allow less reduction in volume of the abdominal cavity as linea alba is brought back together. And actually, the flap may be stronger than the actual linea alba. Remember my CT scans, which I showed you before? You could hardly see the linea alba. This is the peritoneal flap or the hernial sac. It's very easy to see on this CT scan. It's a very strong piece of tissue. When we talk about the linear alba having lines of fibers lined up this way and sutures cut out, scar tissue is a very chaotic arrangement which allows the stitch to be held better in the tissue and not to cut out. So I would put it to you that trying to restore tissue that hasn't been together for a long, long time with tissue that wants to cut out because of the orientation of your fibers may not be a straightforward process. We've heard a lot, and indeed one of the great talks recently on AWRSC was by Dr. Kalinowski and his grip theory. And the basis behind grip, which I will come back to, is the MDAR, which is the mesh defect area ratio. And that is a underpins successful reconstruction of the abdominal wall. Here's your conventional retromuscular sublay. I've kept it simple. I've taken the muscle away, but you'll have anterior rectus sheath closure, posterior rectus sheath closure, and your mesh. But the size of your mesh, in terms of its width, is limited by these nerves that come in and the lateral margin of the muscle. In a so-called peritoneal flap repair, we are actually widening the gap a little, reducing the tension or pressure in here, and we're getting a bigger piece of mesh in. So we are proving the MDAR. And remember this gentleman, Dr. Kalinowski, grip, which is the ability to withstand the coughs and strain post hernia repair, is underpinned by MDAR, along with some things of what mesh you use, how you fix it, the position of the mesh, and closure. And grip varies dramatically with the hernia size. Here's another poor lady where we talk about linea alba closure. She's had some gynecological operation. She's been left looking pregnant. And this is her post-reconstruction. And this is the Andrew Dubose sign. The higher that a patient, in particular a woman, lifts her top above her breasts, the more happy she is with the surgical outcome. Let's have a look at this poor lady's CT scans. Here's her CT scan prior to surgery. There's no rectus muscle on this side at all, so where linea alba is, help me, Dr. Punjani, but I have no idea where it is. But there is a little bit of rectus muscle on this side. Now, I do some cool work with hernias, but I'm not a magician. I can't recreate muscle that's gone. And then this reconstruction a number of years later, you can see there's no rectus muscle there because there was none to start with. But there is an intact myofascial ring. I don't know how I'd have got that to that, which was normal tissue. This is the hernial sac flapping over and bridging the gap, but we can see it's an intact abdomen with good lateral muscles that will work and will contract. So ladies and gentlemen, for me, forget about the linea alba. It's something that we've talked about. It's something that people do talk about, but they're not really quite sure what they're talking about. Remember, it's the intact myofascial cylinder. Come on, get a grip. The mesh defect area ratio is important, and be careful with your hernia size. Intact linea alba, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Is the emperor's clothes? You can hardly see it on a CT scan. You often don't see it too well at surgery, and don't hang your hat on it. Thank you very much.
I think we had two very good talkers. I mean, I thought that they'd we all know that they are one of the best surgeons we have, but they also know that they are great in proving whatever they believe in. Now, I think we'll allow Ramesh Punjani to try and say whatever Andrew said is all false. Can you prove that? Dr. M. Ramesh from
together for a long, long time with tissue that wants to cut out because of the orientation of your fibers may not be a straightforward process. We've heard a lot, and indeed one of the great talks recently on AWRSC was by Dr. Kalinowski and his grip theory. And the basis behind grip, which I will come back to, is the MDAR, which is the mesh defect area ratio. And that is a underpins successful reconstruction of the abdominal wall. Here's your conventional retromuscular sublay. I've kept it simple. I've taken the muscle away, but you'll have anterior rectus sheath closure, posterior rectus sheath closure, and your mesh. But the size of your mesh in terms of its width is limited by these nerves that come in and the lateral margin of the muscle. In a so-called peritoneal flap repair, we are actually widening the gap a little, reducing the tension or pressure in here, and we're getting a bigger piece of mesh in. So we are improving the MDAR. And remember this gentleman, Dr. Kalinowski, grip, which is the ability to withstand the coughs and strain post hernia repair, is underpinned by MDAR, along with some things of what mesh you use, how you fix it, the position of the mesh and closure. And grip varies dramatically with the hernia size. Here's another poor lady where we talk about linea alba closure. She's had some gynecological operation. She's been left looking pregnant. And this is her post-reconstruction. And this is the Andrew Debow sign. The higher that a patient, in particular a woman, lifts her top above her breasts, the more happy she is with the surgical outcome. Let's have a look at this poor lady's CT scans. Here's her CT scan prior to surgery. There's no rectus muscle on this side at all. So where linea alba is, help me, Dr. Punjani, but I have no idea where it is. But there is a little bit of rectus muscle on this side. Now, I do some cool work with hernias, but I'm not a magician. I can't recreate muscle that's gone. And then this reconstruction a number of years later, you can see there's no rectus muscle there because there was none to start with. But there is an intact myofascial ring. I don't know how I'd have got that to that, which was normal tissue. This is the hernial sac flapping over and bridging the gap. But we can see it's an intact abdomen with good lateral muscles that will work and will contract. So ladies and gentlemen, for me, forget about the linea alba. It's something that we've talked about. It's something that people do talk about, but they don't really quite sure what they're talking about. Remember, it's the intact myofascial cylinder. Come on, get a grip. The mesh defect area ratio is important, and be careful with your hernia size. Intact linea alba, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Is the emperor's clothes? You can hardly see it on a CT scan. You often don't see it too well at surgery, and don't hang your hat on it. Thank you very much.
I think we had two very good talkers. I mean, I thought that we all know that they are one of the best surgeons we have, but they also showed that they are great in proving whatever they believe in. Now, I think we'll allow Ramesh Punjani to try and say whatever Andrew said is all false. Can you prove that, Ramesh?
Yeah. Sorry, how do I come out of this? 1 minute, I'll have to close down my presentation first.
What's the rebuttal? How do I come out of this?
Okay, fine. See, can you see this diagram now? What, Andrew? No. No, you can't see. Okay,
one. No, we can't see.
1 minute. Yeah. Okay. Share the screen. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. You can see this diagram.
Yeah.
Now, these are some of the peritoneal flap which I tried to do it. Now, can you see this peritoneal flap with so many Swiss cheese defect?
Yes.
How are you going to reconstruct from such a flimsy tissue? So also here, the thin is so thinned out that by the time we were trying to separate it from subcutaneous tissue, it start tearing. And many times there is a meshes on the top of it. These people have undergone already IPOM, and there are meshes which is attached to this sex. And then how this particular thing is actually going to... Hello?
Are you audible?
Yeah, I'm audible. Yeah. So yeah, this is what, and another thing what Andrew said is that on a radiology you can't see. Now on radiology if you can't see, but on a microscopy you can see a collagen fibers. What is more reliable? Is it a radiology or a microscopy? I think what they have seen under a microscope and sawn the elastic tissues and the collagen tissue, I would rely more on that. He says that there is a more mass defect area ratio in pulmonary in peritoneal fluid, which I disagree, because in case you are finding that the two linear seminaries are too close to each other, you do a transverse abdominis release and you put much bigger mesh. So mass defect area ratio in a TAR is one of the highest. It is a giant prosthetic replacement of visceral sac. So therefore, what is important is that all what he said is, I don't think it holds true. I still believe that linea alba is required to be closed in AWR. Thank you.
Yeah, strong points from Ramesh.
Yeah.
Can we have Andrew prove his point?
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Punjani. Well said. I see you had to go back to some slides to try and explain what you're doing. I won't bother with any slides because the argument's won already. I think one of the issues has been this direct linear alba closure. I accept that the mesh defect area ratio may be bigger if you use a TAR to close the abdomen, but we know that the majority of midline hernias are closed without a TAR. And what that means is the poor linea alba has been putting on a lot of strain, and even in expert hands, like in Malmo, which has a long history, they have a 10% recurrence rate where they do a standard retrorectus, and they get a 1% recurrence rate when they use the peritoneal flap technique. For me, when a direct comparison like that is impossible to say. You talked about radiology. Well, I do look at my radiology. You talked about a microscope. Well, I'm not too bothered what I see under a microscope. I do wear glasses because I'm a bit visually impaired now, but I certainly don't use magnifying when I operate, and I use the tissues that are there. And a very interesting study which came out of India looking at the peritoneum, when it's used to bridge a defect in muscle, actually undergoes morphological change to lay down scar tissue. We must remember that scar tissue happens in response to stimulus. Bones heal because they're stressed. Tendons get thicker because they're used. And what may start off as flimsy material to begin with, combined with your mesh and two layers of them, they will hold together. And remember the lateral hernias where the linea alba was intact. You made no comment about that. And leaving the linea alba intact, but a hole laterally, you don't get too much function either. So ladies and gentlemen, once again, I tell you, the linea alba is the emperor's clothes, and be very careful when you laugh and congratulate the emperor when they're naked. Thank you very much.
Anything, just 1 minute, you have one or two sentences, Ramesh?
I think if you see the definition of AWR, can I just share one last slide?
Okay.
Yeah, just very quickly. If you see this slide, abdominal reconstruction is a surgery involving reconstruction of the abdominal wall in order to restore anatomy and function. It involves the closure of fascia at the midline, often with renewed. So this is what is the definition of AWR. Now, we may do any number of procedures for hernia, but that is not abdominal wall reconstruction. According to me, reconstruction is recreation of construction, which I said earlier. So therefore, if you say AWR, the linea alba needs to be closed.
Okay. So we have two very strong guys here trying to wrestle and nobody's falling down. And then it becomes very difficult thing. I can imagine what happens to our judges if there are two advocates who are really strong on both sides. I pity our judges every day. What I would say is, these are things that I feel are required. One is, we always aim at a tension-free repair, which I feel is a winner. We have to do something that can make a collagen stronger. So we've been using a prosthesis trying to stimulate collagen synthesis and things like that, because we know all this is happening because of collagen weakness. We're not actually depending on muscles to hold most of the time. And then the last thing that I want to say is, the proof of pudding is in eating. We can go on with logics, but then we need to have evidence-based medicine. And then I think Andrew is trying to do something innovative. Right from Galileo, anybody who tried to do something new have found criticism for whatever they did. And I think only time will be the answer I think 10 years from now, I'll pass the judgment who's been great between you two. Having said that, I think it was a great job, fantastic argument, fantastic facts that both of you have brought. And I leave it to Rajesh and Albert to comment.
Yeah,
that was a great.
Yeah, Albert, please.
Yeah, that was a great debate. I think both of them has put their argument very nicely. For me, if Punjani is right, Andrew is definitely not wrong. And as Ramesh has said, time will tell who is right. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, you see, both of you have wonderfully put your case forward. And I would say that both of you are winner. Why? Because in hernia, no one technique can be ideal for every patient. It's very important to select a technique of repair of hernia according to the patient's need. For all of us, a patient is first and foremost. We must find a way of surgery which suits that particular patient very well in the long run. That is what is most important. And thank you very much. Thank you, Andrew. It was good to see you. Although it is virtual, but yes, definitely. And thank you, Ramesh. And thank you, everyone who has attended this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For conducting this wonderful program. All of us have enjoyed it. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think I have saved 5 minutes for the Indo-UCO surgery call. The debate was the cherry on the cake. Really enjoyed. I thank Dr. Andrew for giving us the time for this wonderful debate, Ramesh Punjani for this debate, and the chairpersons, Dr. Ramesh, Dr. Albert, and Dr. Kullar, for chairing this session. And I will be now wrapping this up, but I will ask all of you to hold back for the orations, which is coming up in another 3 to 4 minutes of time. This will be the time that we can all take for our own physiological functions. And we can assemble after 3 or 4 minutes. I hope everybody enjoyed this session as much as I've enjoyed watching you all. Thank you once again, guys. See you in 3 to 4 minutes.
Thank you. See you.